Hello and welcome to Legally Speaking with me, Tarun Nangia. Very recently, a landmark judgment was authored by Chief Justice of India, Justice N.V. Ramanna, that spoke about the Benami Transaction Prohibition Amendment Act 2016 and said that it cannot be applied retroactively, which is retrospectively. Why this is very important is what is we are going to discuss today. And I have a very eminent panel to go into the details of this judgment and why it's important for so many people who are being either prosecuted under this or also a lot of businessmen who were scared that, you know, this Benami Transaction Prohibition Amendment Act would be applied retrospectively to their cases. May I welcome Senior Advocate Pinky Anand. Ma'am has served as the Additional Solicitor General of India. Good to see you. I have with me Advocate Abhimanyu Bhandari, who practices at the Supreme Court of India and also the Delhi High Court. I have with me Advocate Shravan Shankar, who practices in Delhi at the Delhi High Court and the Supreme Court. I have with me Sanjeev Sharma, who joins us for the first time. Good to see you, Mr. Sharma. He's a partner with Saraf and Partners, one of India's leading law firms. And at the outset, may I request Ma'am Pinky Anand to say a few words before we begin the discussion?
Tarun, this indeed has been a situation where, you know, we are talking about something which is either an accepted practice by law and by society, or it is not. Now, the immediate concern arises from the fact that, fine, there was some, you know, transition of property to another person where there might be some issue. So the whole question here is, it is Benami transactions was recognized under the Indian Trusts Act. It is recognized under the Indian Companies Act. It is recognized as such in society. But what the Act did, the original Act of 1988, was to hold that if you held the property in somebody else's name, save and except for wife and daughter, in the interest of daughter, which is the only exclusion, it would be a Benami transaction if somebody paid for a property, it was held by somebody else. And in addition, aside from the civil nature or the banning nature, a criminal liability was foisted by a non-bailable, non-cognizable situation for an imprisonment up to 3 years. Now, as you probably see in the judgment in Ganpat, ultimately, it has been found that this criminal provision has not even been utilized very much in the sense of it has not come to finalities. But the question is of prosecution of people who are ultimately holding it in trust, which the amendment of 2016 brought in. So obviously, even the, you know, as far as the legislature is concerned, it did consider the fact that in order to foist liability, it had to be because of some violation of a law or evading a law. Only in that case, you would have the necessary mens rea. So the idea is you must have a guilty mind, a guilty intent, and a guilty mens rea, so to say, as we call in Latin, ultimately, the intention to be able to be held as liable for a criminal offense, which is one of the primary concerns of criminal law. You cannot normally have any question of strict liability in such a transitional position, which is recognized ultimately under the various laws of the country and which stands valid. So that includes, as I said, the Trust Act, the Companies Act. This is what I think came into issue because a number of people were facing, in one sense or the other, prosecution or disproportionate situations, which led to this whole situation of pre-2016. So 2016, you have one batch of people. Pre-2016, you have another batch of people. When the legislature itself accepts that you have to have a reason to prosecute people for holding property in somebody else's name, when it is for a bona fide reason, either for a mentally retarded child or for a trust for a partnership or conveyance of that kind. So I think this is the backdrop of why the court has stepped in to equalize the situation pre-2016 and post-2016.
Thanks for that opening comment, Ma'am Pinky Anand. I'll go to Advocate Abhimanyu Bhandari. Mr. Bhandari, you take up a lot of these kind of matters, and I remember you would always explain the issue with an anecdote. So may I also request you to share an anecdote when you explain this?
Sure. I think, Tarun, I should, in no uncertain words, I should say that this is a very, very landmark judgment. It's a very, very landmark judgment, not only because of the facts and circumstances of the case where they were dealing with a particular law called the Benami law, but because the court re-emphasizes a very important constitutional principle. And that is that any law in this country cannot be a law if it is not right, if it is not just, if it is not fair. An arbitrary law has no place in our constitutional framework. And that's a principle which we've seen from Meneka Gandhi's case, we've seen in the dissent of Gopalan's case, which again the court re-emphasizes, and actually just not only re-emphasizes it and declares it, but implements it by holding that the act cannot be applied retrospectively, and also holds that a particular provision in the act is manifestly arbitrary and therefore ultra vires the constitution. This judgment, Tarun, is very important, and I'll give you an example why it is important. Benami, many people had entered into, let's say, Benami transactions without there actually being any guilty mind. So, for example, a person transferring money to his friend so that friend could buy a property which that person could use. And that may not have been anything guilty there, because the person who gave him the money to buy that property was tax paid money. The person who bought the property bought it, kept it, you know, and allowed and really kept it for the use of person A, who had actually given the money. So one would also question that, really, do we need to prosecute someone for something like this? Because there is, at the end of the day, no evasion of taxes. It's not like B is actually using it as his property. It's A who's actually using it as his property. Therefore, this provision was what people, the term people use, stillborn. There was no prosecution, Tarun. Since 1988, when the act came in, there was no prosecution. No one was ever prosecuted under this act. Suddenly in 2016, an amendment comes and changes the complete framework of the act, changes the procedural aspects of the act, changes the substantive aspects of the act, and says, sorry, we will also now attach and in certain cases prosecute those who've been entered into this transaction way back before these amendments came back in 2016. Therefore, rightfully, people rushed to constitutional courts in our country and said, you cannot do that. And Calcutta High Court came to the rescue of the person and said, yes, you cannot apply an act retrospectively. This then went up all the way to Supreme Court, and Supreme Court affirmed the judgment of Calcutta High Court and actually laid down the law and went through. And let me tell you, three honorable judges of Supreme Court took the pains to recollect and tell us and show us the history of how, you know, evolution of constitutional principles have come in and set into motion over many years, where it has been held that a law cannot be applied retrospectively, especially a law where there is no, as learned senior advocate Pinky Anand says, there is no mens rea whatsoever. So this is a very, very landmark judgment. And if one reads the judgment, there are parts of the judgment which will impact other statutes, Tarun, because the principle of law that this judgment expounds, reaffirms, and teaches us and tells us is something which can be applied in other provisions where authorities are allowed to arbitrarily attach assets of people, assets which were bought way back before that particular legislation came into place. So let me tell you, Tarun, one of the biggest cases which it will statute it will impact the principle of this law is the PMLA Act, the Money Laundering Act, because there is a part in the judgment which tells us that, look, what an act does here is that it taints the very property. See, please understand, Tarun, when properties are attached, right, what happens is you're attaching the property. You're saying that property is tainted because it is Benami. So you're creating a taint in the property, not in the person only, but in the property. Therefore, if that property has been bought before the act came into motion, then of course you can't taint that property in that manner. And therefore, the similar principle would apply to other acts which are trying to draw back retroactively or retrospectively a taint in a property which, when it was bought, was untainted, and you taint it subsequently by bringing in a legislation. So, for example, this very question, as you know, is, Tarun, very much alive, and we've discussed this in your shows many times, whether the PMLA Act can be applied retrospectively. If the Benami Act cannot be applied retrospectively because of the reason that you're tainting the property, and when the property was bought, there was no taint in it, and you're creating a taint subsequently, then the same thing you're doing under the PMLA Act, where you're attaching a property which may have been bought before 2005, before the PMLA Act came in, And you are using that value thereof, that little word, those two words, value thereof in the Proceeds of Crime Act, Tarun, if you remember, to attach old property. So I think that if one reads this judgment comes to the rescue of not only those who are stuck by the Benami Act, but also those who are suffering the rigors of the PMLA Act, because when they bought the property, there was no taint in that property.
Thanks for explaining this beautifully. I'll go across to Advocate Shravan Shankar for his opening comment.
Thank you, Tarun. So perhaps I can give you a small historic anecdote, very interesting food anecdote, interesting fact is that there was a dessert which is called Benami Kheer. That is to actually hide the secret ingredient, which is garlic, which is made to use the dessert. Similarly, this kind of transaction, what is hidden is the person behind it, who's behind the curtain. Now, what happens are some people who want, for the benefit of the non-law viewers, some people who want to keep their identity incognito, operate in the name of Benami of their own benefit. There are several benefits of it. They see it this way: to deploy unaccounted money, to escape from the clutches of the tax law, to deceive revenue authorities, to skirt land sealing laws, or, you know, to defraud institutions, or also to make more money out of it. Now, in fact, this law has come into play in 1988. However, this was reported by the Law Commission in the year 1973. 15 years after it was reported, a 2-page, 9-section, a dead letter enactment was made in the year 1988. This act, essentially, the original act, the first act said this: it prohibits the Benami transaction. It basically says that a property purchased by one person for a consideration provided or paid by another person is Benami transaction. So even if I gift you something, it can turn into a Benami transaction. So the punishment here was very limited to about 3 years or fine. Now, the most important aspect is that this but the procedure which is required to come in to find which transaction is a Benami, that was not notified. The rules did not stand notified until 2016. And also the authority to which this property will vest with, they will be acquired by an authority, that was also not notified. So it more or less remained dead. Now in 2016, the new comprehensive amendment which came in to give an effective regime to the Benami Transaction Prohibition Act. So then they expanded the definition. And then they said that even if it was provided for the benefit of another person subsequently to get, then also it will get covered. So here in this present case, the Honorable Supreme Court actually was overcome a very interesting hurdle. This transaction, which was held to be, which was under proceeding, is a 2011 transaction. The Act came in 2016. The amendment came in 2016. But the Supreme Court went into the constitutionality of the retrospective applicability of this transaction, of the law. Now, the Supreme Court overcame this by saying that there need not be any challenge on the validity for the Supreme Court to actually hold anything ultra vires. So this is something very interesting about this case.
Okay. Thanks for sharing those details going back to 1973. I'll go to Sanjeev Sharma. He's partner with Saraf and Partners. Mr. Sharma, your opening comment on this issue.
Yeah, thank you, Tarun, first of all, for having me on the program. I think this landmark judgment, there are two important takeaways. And first and the foremost, my learned colleagues, Pinky Anand and Abhimanyu, have already touched on that mens rea is very important part of the criminal jurisprudence. However, this judgment also clarifies, merely because the object of the statute is to eradicate a civil evil or for a larger benefit of the society, would not be a decisive factor to exclude a guilty mind. So I think this is a very important takeaway. And the second important takeaway, which I feel is important to look into, is that while deciding the constitutionality of a particular provision, the court says that the jurisprudence has taken a full circle, where from the formalistic test of classification, it has moved to the test of manifest arbitrariness. And based on this test itself, a particular provision can be treated as unconstitutional. I think this is a very important takeaway. And I think in the opening comments, I think these are the two things which I just want to say.
Thanks for that opening comment from you. I'll go to Ma'am Pinky Anand. Now, after this judgment, would all proceedings involving Benami transactions pre-2016 be quashed? Is it now over? All these cases stand withdrawn?
They definitely do. You have a judgment of the Supreme Court which holds in terms that the 2008 Act itself is ultra vires to the extent of the criminal prosecution and the vagueness and the disproportionate part and the fact that it is violative of Article 14 and other fundamental rights of individuals. In view of that, the whole purpose was that you cannot actually have, in fact, Abhimanyu pointed out earlier, you didn't have prosecution. 2016 amendment comes and suddenly there is prosecution of pre-2016. So the whole purpose was that you cannot have such a prosecution of such people and that too in such a belated fashion based upon a legislation which has a purpose of preventing any illegitimate activity such as avoidance of law, but not any legitimate activity. And Benami transaction by itself is not an illegitimate transaction. And as long as it is not, you can't be prosecuted. So definitely pre-2016, all prosecutions, if any launched or to be launched, would not stand the scrutiny of law today.
Thanks, because a lot of common viewers would want to know the status of their cases. Maybe they heave a sigh of relief after this. I'll go to Mr. Bhandari now. You talked about the extension of this judgment to the PMLA Act. Could you expound on that further?
Sure. So Tarun, what happens is that how attachment works is that whether it is the Benami or the PMLA, when an investigating agency is investigating a case, if, for example, under the, let's take the PMLA case, they say, look, this asset that is there is bought from proceeds of crime. So the person says that I bought this asset in the year 2000 or 2003 when there was no PMLA Act. The PMLA Act came in 2005. So at that time, there was no money laundering. So you can't say that this asset is tainted and is a fruit of a proceeds of crime. But courts, the authorities say that that doesn't matter. The fact that you still have the asset or you have the asset in some other form with you still, and the act came in 2005 and you still possess that asset. Therefore, we can still attach it because you're still enjoying that asset. Now, here is where they fall foul of our constitutional principle. The constitutional principle as expounded in this particular judgment that you cannot apply a law retrospectively. Therefore, this judgment actually mentions in a particular paragraph the landmark PMLA decision, and it actually states that the attachment provision there needs to be looked and expounded upon at some, you know, in future at some time, because that has really not been tested by the court. Let me be very fair. In the landmark PMLA judgment, the attachment was not debated or was not argued to that kind of extent, because more thrust was on whether a copy of the ECIR should be provided and there were other ancillary issues. And I think it is time that the courts relook not only the PMLA attachment provisions, but attachment provisions in various other acts, which allows investigating agencies to find a way to attach properties which have been bought much before that attachment provision has come into birth. So a person who bought a property in 1990 suffers an attachment in 2022 when there was no such law in 1990 when he bought it. So therefore, to go and claw back those assets as proceeds of crime or as Benami transactions is, I think, completely wrong. And this now needs to be relooked. So therefore, the Section 8 of the PMLA Act, which actually this Benami judgment refers to, one has to relook at it and see whether there are sufficient checks and balances, belts and braces to ensure that the provision is not misused and attachments are contained on future properties, not on properties which were bought or acquired much before the Act came into existence.
Thanks for explaining that in detail. Now we move on to a round of final comments. I'll just start with Advocate Shravan Shankar, your comment.
So Tarun, since the amendment has come in force from say November 2016 to July 2017, in less than 1 year, 400 transactions have been scrutinized, 230 properties have been attached, and the worth of those properties is about roughly 800 crores. I'm just telling, this is 1 year. There was a question put to the finance minister based on which this answer has come. And now Subsequently, what the other tenet of law, which is very important, is that what you can't do directly, you can't do indirectly. Now, pre-2016 regime, you couldn't have done what the state is trying to do in post-2016 amendment. In fact, that is the score on which the High Court initially, whose judgment has been upheld, where the constitutionality of the provisions of the 1988 Act then has been held ultra vires qua Article 21. So this is something what it can't be doing. And again, how Sanjeev Sharmaji has explained, the doctrine of manifest arbitration, arbitrariness, which is to do with something excessive or disproportionate use of power. So these have been certain things which the Supreme Court has gone into. It was mostly concerned with two provisions, which is Section 3 and Section 5, where they say that it completely ignores the aspect of mens rea. So as most of my friends expounded.
Thanks for that closing comment. I'll go to Mr. Sanjeev Sharma from Saraf and Partners for his closing comment.
Yeah, in fact, before giving my closing comment, I just want to add to what Abhimanyu talked about, the PMLA judgment in Vijay Mandalal Chaudhary's case. So while explaining Section 8 of PMLA, what the court basically was talking about, court was actually detailing the difference between acquisition and confiscation and explaining the provisions of Section 27 of Benami Transaction Act, the court talked about or discussed the issue of interim possession. So court says that whether actually what the PMLA, right, PMLA decision the Supreme Court has held, that this is a right provision because of the specific nature and special statute which is therein. So the court says that these principles, which basically upholds these interim possessions, are required to be more expounded, and it is required to be looked into. So this is something which I just want to add to Abhimanyu. Along with that, I think what the court ultimately basically comes to the conclusion that the scope of a statute which has basically criminal manifestation, which basically impose criminal liability on a particular person, cannot be enlarged by merely saying that these are the provisions which basically adds to the process. So the scope that way cannot be enlarged. So this is something which is very important, and I think would definitely lead to lot of further clarification in the subsequent judgments which may come from the Supreme Court.
Thanks for sharing that. I'll go to Mr. Bhandari for his closing comment.
So Tarun, I think that my closing comment would be that, we've had the Black Money Act, we've had the Prevention of Money Laundering Act, we've had the Benami Act. I think now for lawyers like us who are on the defense side, I think the Benami Act judgment gives us confidence to again go back to court and argue whether all these acts can be applied retrospectively or not. You know, we were thinking that this whole argument on retrospectivity has now, run out in some ways. But I think that after this judgment, those arguments will come back with much more vigor. And we are, of course, going to see some very good arguments in court, and I suppose some exceptionally better judgments, very good judgments in court, which will reinforce that acts, especially penal statutes and penal acts, cannot be applied retrospectively, because we've come a long way in our constitutional jurisprudence. And if one sees the Benami Act judgment, the judgment takes pains to not only set out historical Indian judgments on this, but also, pens out judgments from other countries and shows that how an act cannot be applied retrospectively. This judgment is a delight to read, and the kind of jurisprudence that it brings out encourages us to again go out and test and battle that, look, you cannot apply a penal provision retrospectively. I think there is a lot more to come.
Thanks for the closing comments. And you said there's a lot more to come. I think I'd like to ask that to you in the next episode. I'll go across to Ma'am Pinky Anand for her closing comment.
Tarun, I believe that the landmark judgment has ensured the rule of law essentially, and brought back into criminal jurisprudence and the fold of criminal jurisprudence the fact that the Benami transactions by nature appear to have been founded on beneficial ownership and not necessarily a violation of law. So to uphold that factum that you cannot prosecute without the mens rea which is needed to make a criminal act a criminal act and an offense, I think that is one of the most important parameters, that the court recognizes the fact that the essential element of Benami transaction doesn't lie in any deliberate violation and therefore non-prosecutable within that capacity. And that will, of course, lead to higher jurisprudence in a number of areas, as we were talking.
So, indeed,
I think just want to add last one sentence, that we should not be losing sight of one important fact, that the court has kept open the challenge to the forfeiture provisions of even the 2016 amendment. So this is something which would definitely be raked up, which would definitely be taken up later on, because this is something which is very important to the base of this particular statute.
Thanks for very good point. That's a very good point. Yes.
Thanks for that input, Mr. Sharma. And as we've seen that this judgment authored by Justice Ramana, and also the bench which had Justice Ramana, Justice Krishna Murari, and Justice Hima Kohli, who were on the bench. And very importantly, when you say that Benami Transactions Acts cannot be applied retrospectively, has generated a lot of curiosity among the business classes in the country, because whenever there are laws, when businesses realize that, you know, they can be penalized retrospectively by a law being brought in or a law being amended, it hurts investments. It also hurts the business sentiment. And so I think the right sense has prevailed. And then again, our Supreme Court has come to the rescue. And that is why we should thank the Supreme Court of India, especially this bench, rightly so. I would like to thank Ma'am Pinky Anand, Advocate Abhimanyu Bhandari, Advocate Shravan Shankar, Sanjeev Sharma, partner Saraf and partners, for sparing time for this very important issue. And thank you, viewers, for tuning in on this one. Thank you so very much.
Thank you so much.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.